we've really just been talking about how can you pump up or boost protein expression. And it's a better way of thinking about it is that there are trade-offs, and there is some things such as too much protein. And so when we think about the kind of protein yield that we might get versus translation initiation rate or the strength of expression, we can imagine a curve that goes up to some extent, maybe steadies out, and then could precipitously decline. This isn't necessarily true for every protein, but this is what we would expect for most proteins. And the reason is because if your protein is soluble, not very toxic, expresses well, then as you are increasing the expression strength, again, with this focus on translation initiation, so stronger RBS, you'd expect to see more overall protein yield. And remember, your protein yield, these proteins are being made by a cell that's shifting resources towards overexpression of your protein. So what you don't see in this plot are the underlying dynamics of cell growth. But you'd imagine that your cell growth rates might be not too affected in this regime. We're slowly starting to come down in terms of the rate in which they double, but maybe they still reach the same final density. And so then in this higher strength range, you see a steadying out because you may be entering a case where too much of your resources are being shifted towards protein production, creating limitations in the process that have nothing to do with what your actual translation initiation rate ends up being. If you have a limitation in ribosome recycling, you might have a stronger initiation rate, but there are just not more 30S free subunits ready to come find your RNA. You could have run out of a particular amino acid. And of course the cell is, you're typically not running out of an amino acid. The cell is going to try to compensate for that with all the regulation that we've seen and drive more flux into those pathways. But it might find that costs more energy. It might essentially double at a slower rate. And here you might find that trade-off means that the stronger you go in expression, you're just not actually going to increase the total amount of protein that you get. And then in this really high regime, you can end up in a situation where your protein is being either expressed so quickly and when there isn't a limitation that it's not folding correctly, or it's just ending up while not fully folded, or even once fully folded, aggregating because of the concentration and density. Maybe particularly if it's not correctly folded, it can be causing problems within the cell. And this diversion of resources could start to look really severe. And so you can actually end up in a situation where you might transform a strain of, say, E. coli bacteria with a plasmid, and it's got such a strong constitutive promoter that when you try to look at your plate, your agar plates, or grow a liquid culture, you just don't see cell growth for a day or even two because of how slowly it's growing. I see a hand raised.
I was wondering, something like the RBS calculator, does it sort of take something like this into account when it's maximizing RBS strength, that it knows at some point it's going to be too strong?
No, it doesn't. That is a great question. That is very much up for the user to empirically find out. Because in order for it to do that, it would have to have a lot of knowledge about what your protein is, and potentially many other aspects. But because the toxicity and unique intermediate folding states of your protein can play such a role, all it's going to tell you is predicted translation initiation rate. And so if you are going about this as an experimentalist, because it's relatively easy to clone multiple RBSs, even for the same construct. A wise thing to do, if you have a protein that you really care about, or you really want to collect a large quantity of, or for metabolic engineering, it's your rate limiting enzyme, you know, try it. You want to try a few different RBSs. And then you find that, you know, it's kind of interesting because you would think, if I go back and maybe interlinked with your question, this measured fluorescence, at some point, if you get really high predicted transition initiation rate, you would expect to see more cases maybe where fluorescent, where this dips. And this might have a lot to do with the fact that fluorescent proteins are often really stable, really well-folding proteins. But there are some, maybe exemplified here, where you see this deviation from linearity. And I mean, there aren't enough points here to really make that claim strongly, but it is not, and it's probably because the authors, when trying to characterize translation initiation rate, didn't perhaps want to spend too much time in a regime where their predictions wouldn't be useful, right? So I wouldn't be surprised if actually you can predict stronger translation initiation rates here, and then you continue to see a dip like this. Did that answer your question?
Yep,